to be outdone by its French sister Peugeot, Renault have also decided that they are going to reface one of their major cars. So we're now in a D segment again with the Renault Laguna, which has always been a massively popular fleet car, and it now receives a totally new front end. Da-da-da-da! It is really, really nice. Loving the new bonnet, love the new lines and curvature on the bonnet. The new lights are superb, including across the top here, this aluminium strip that really heightens to focus this section of the light and sort of puts this almost as part of the bonnet. It is just the front on the car that's changed. The back's had a very light lift. We've now got much deeper, solid, more beefier front bumper. And then obviously we've also got this really big Renault embossed in the front. Some might think that that's been changed to match in with the Laguna Coupe, which has proved a massive, massive seller. But oddly, the Laguna Coupe doesn't in fact get the new front end. It still receives the same bulbous headlights. So, and if we look inside the car, where somebody's left a stereo on, we have a slightly improved dash, nothing major. We're not seeing a huge difference in the inside of the car, just mainly that front, but it should keep the car fresh and current. I bring you the bearer of bad news. For this car behind me, this hideous monstrosity behind me, is the new Nissan Micra. Quite what Nissan were thinking when they took the cute, wobbly, pinky Nissan Micra and turned it into this, I do not know. They have managed to make it look like, well, it's kind of like a taxi from the Far East. It is horrible. It looks like a Toyota Starlet from 1980. I don't know at what point the designers took a look at the car and said, what a Micra needs is big buggy eyes. That's what it needs. Yeah, big bug eyes, rawr, that bulge out from the car, right? And then what we'll do is we'll iron the front and that will be the new Micra front. And then we'll just bang out the panels and then just give it a Porsche edge. We'll raise the panels. They go into the, yeah, that'll work. So then we'll come down the car and we'll iron out anything that might be remotely classed as a body line, and we'll put this daft half hip in. And then when we get to the back of the car, we will have created the most cardinal sin of all, which is we've given it a flat back with protruding round lights that are oval. Oh, it's hideous. I mean, there is no way of finding anything likeable about this new Micra, apart from the fact that it's got 120 grams of CO2, so it's going to be quite cheap to insure. But to be fair, nobody is ever going to try and steal this car. It has got the sort of rear end. It does look like somebody's already run into it. So I wouldn't bother insuring it. Actually, no, I shan't say that, because you'll be driving around without insurance and I'll go and get sued. So drive it with insurance, but I'm trying to do a comedy point in the fact that, yeah, it isn't worth the road tax. It's horrible and it is not particularly nice at all. However, what they have managed to knock out that is quite pleasant is the new Leaf, which is their energy efficient zero emissions car. Goes on sale in the middle of next year and is a true style magnet. Looks a little bit like a Peugeot from the front, a bit 2070, which is odd because obviously they share everything with Renault, so you'd think it would look like a Clio, but it doesn't. And really pleasant little car there, four-door eco car. But, and this is where it all goes horribly wrong, this is obviously Nissan and Renault are a partnership company Nissan and Renault are a partnership company, that's what I'm trying to say, it's been a long day. And so now we're going to go back over to Renault stand, we're going to show you what they've got in the way of eco motoring. And it is a little bit embarrassing for Nissan. We'll be right back. look at their new ZE policies, which are the new zero emissions cars. Now, these are superb. They've just announced them. Last week they announced the pricing for them, so we have the first one. Let's start with the Renault Twizy. I've no idea what this car is about. It's a two-seater. It's all electric. It'll go up to 60 miles on a single charge, 3.5 hours to charge the car fully. Doesn't have any top windows. That is the problem with our climate anyway. Probably great if you're in Europe, but not so hot if you're in the UK in Europe, because that's the bit that gets all the rain. However, that is going to start from just £5,500. So very, very cheap. It's a two-seater. There is no room for shopping. And you wouldn't want to put it in the bottom, would you, really? But it's quite cool. It's meant for an urban dweller. We have no idea what that means. Apparently, it's people that don't like to travel more than 60 miles. And then we come to the Fluence. Now, in Europe, this is actually a Mégane with a boot. It's actually a Mégane with a boot. And this is sort of like just a general saloon. However, this Fluence is a few millimetres longer. And it's actually a zero emissions car. So that extra few inches in the back is actually all battery. And again, this is another one of Renault's cars. This is going to be about £15,000 when it launches in 2012. Same as this, this is launched 2012. So we've got £5,000, got £15,000. And it's actually a nice looking car. It looks really sporty. Definitely a nicer look than the Prius. And then we come across, because heaven forbid, the one sector that is left out of all of these eco zero emission things is actually industry. An industry that want a serviceable, sensible car. But it's a zero emissions kind of van, so it's a plug-in. And this is designed directly for corporates that have a social responsibility, a corporate responsibility to reduce their emissions. And it's a Renault Kangoo. Really, pretty much, that's all it is. But the front does change because obviously it's a zero emissions car, so it doesn't need a grill because there's nothing to overheat because it's all just batteries. Now, this particular car is designed purely for corporates type sort of thing, whereas the Fluence is far more designed for end users. And I've just remembered that although I said it was 15,000 in it, it's actually 17.5, and you have to lease the battery. So don't forget to factor that into the cost when you're looking at Fluence. You do have to lease the battery. You can buy it for a couple of grand more, but chaos breeze. Now, if we carry on round Renault stand, Zoe preview, 90% of this car will make it to production, and it is their brand new Eco. They launched it about a year ago in Geneva, and that particular car was only going to be 70% of the actual finished car. So they've come back to Paris Motor Show with a far more sensible based car for production. Tweak the lights a little bit, tweak the rear lights a little bit, take out the plant. Obviously, I mean, they might sell it with an oxygen plant. It would be a brilliant idea. I mean, it'd be very colourful, but this is pretty much the finished product. And it's going to be about £12,000 on the road, which is super cheap for an eco car. Put it up against Toyota Auris and you're looking for the hybrid version at spending at least another £8,000. So it is well worth the money. It is a four-seater though, not a five-seater. The interior will change slightly, but it will remain a four-seater with a very small boot capacity. But again, it's going to do 60 miles on a single charge, 3.5 hours to charge up, and 0-60 in about 9.5 seconds, which actually is fairly sprightly for a full battery-powered car. But do remember, don't go any further than 60 miles from home without a very, very long plug. Now, moving on, Renault have taken this opportunity to launch their sports car. Now, again, this could be a flight of fantasy for Renault, or it might not be. It could also be another zero emissions car, or it could actually just be a normal petrol or diesel. Designed squarely at the RCZ market, the Peugeot RCZ market and TT, this is designed to be a supercar. However, it is the Desire, which is a really cool two-door car. It's a two-seater, suicide door, sports coupe, aimed purely at the domestic market. It is quite cool. It's very unlikely this car will make it as it is into production. However, some elements of it may come through, or it may actually be made the way it is and they might sell a few. To, you know, George Clooney or something, Val Kilmer, something that misses Batman. But overall, I think it's a really cool car, in regardless of the guys it's in. We'll be right back.